Tisse and Pravodnikov. And again, we're in the same 140-pound weight class where you saw Crawford and Delorme. And they are just about the same age. It's a 16-month difference. Matisse, slightly the older of the two. He also has a half-inch height advantage. Most significantly, perhaps, a 2.5-inch arm-length advantage measured from the armpit to the end of the fist. That tells you that if it's a boxing match, Matisse will have a certain advantage in space. Weigh in, Matisse was 1 pound under the 140-pound limit. Pravodnikov, 139.5 pounds, a half pound from the 140-pound limit. And just to continue with the theme of equality that I began in the on-camera with Bernard, tonight they have both rehydrated up to exactly 151 pounds. Lucas Matisse is a unique individual. He's got unconventional interests and certainly an out-of-the-box family. Let's take a closer look.
We come from a family of fighters. My father started. He was amongst the best in Argentina. My brother Walter, he had a fight for world championship against Paul Williams.
Great right counter from Matisse.
My sister Soledad, she's a world champion currently. And my mother also had one fight, and then she retired. I think that we all have that same style. We come to fight. I started following my father's footsteps. We had good results, and I liked what I was doing. So now we've had good success. Well, as a kid, you know, I would draw. And then as I grew, I did a tattoo, and my mother didn't say anything. So then after that, I did another one. They didn't say anything. So then after that, I started getting a whole bunch. Done my own here on my chest, on my legs. You know, I'm not a very good artist. You know, as a hobby, I'll do it, but truthfully, I don't know what I'll do when I retire.
You have to love a guy who is revered by people around him as a tattoo artist and will say to us on camera, I'm not really very good at it. One thing he is good at is power punching. Bernard, it is reported that in 40 fights, he has knocked 37 of those opponents down at some point in the fight. Can we agree that part of the reason for that is he seems equally powerful from both the left and the right side?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, he has powerful fans. He showed that in previous fights, and he's going to use those. I believe that's his biggest asset, and he's going to try to use that as much as possible because that's his starting point in the fight.
On the other hand, he's been knocked down in two of his last three fights. Knocked down by Danny Garcia, knocked down twice, although one of them was questionable in his fight of the year last year with John Molina. Do you sense that he's getting reckless as he tries to get to the top of the division?
Well, it's his style. I mean, he's working with things that he's done in the past and he's successful with it. And it's a risk. It's always a risk. But he has a crowd-pleasing fighting style, and I don't think he's going to abandon that anytime soon.
All right, Lucas Matisse is in the ring. You see a list there of his recent appearances. Three of them were wins. One of them was a loss to Danny Garcia. With the May 2 super fight between Floyd Mayweather and Manny Pacquiao fast approaching, Pravodnikov's trainer Freddie Roach has opted to stay in camp with Pacquiao in Los Angeles. He has dispatched aide-de-camp Marvin Simoteo to be in Pravodnikov's corner this evening. And we got Ruslan's thoughts about the transition.
Freddie Roach is primarily focused on Manny Pacquiao's next fight. I don't feel left out, because the most important thing is, Freddie is in the gym every day preparing me for the fight with Matisse. It's never perfect. There are always some types of hurdles that you have to overcome. It has happened before, and it wasn't a problem. Freddie and his assistant Marvin Simoteo are both actively involved in my training. Marvin and the rest of the team will be here with me, so I'm not worried about not having Freddie in my corner. I really trust Marvin. He's a very talented trainer. Mark my words, one day he will win the Trainer of the Year award.
And here comes Ruslan Pravodnikov. Even though he got a get-well knockout win over Jose Luis Castillo in Russia in November, Pravodnikov acknowledges he's still trying to shake off the disappointment, and the bitter disappointment, I should call it, of his controversial split decision loss to Chris Algieri in New York last summer. How does that affect a fighter mentally coming into a fight like this, Bernard?
Well, it affects him a lot. It has to be on his mind. But it's also a motivational tool also, because he knows he wants that filling in his mouth again. He don't want to taste it again. And look, he's going to fight harder, and he's corrected, I believe, those issues. But you know what? No matter what, I think he's going to bring all his A-game, and that's what makes a great fight.
You mentioned the knockdowns that Matisse has suffered in two of the last three fights. Probodnikov has never been down as an amateur or a pro. If this is a war, is that an advantage?
Oh, absolutely. It's an advantage for him because he loves wars. I mean, he don't duck too many punches, and he's won many, many good matches by coming forward, taking some to get some.
All right. Most people here are on their feet and ready. Let's go to ring announcer Ray Flores to start it off.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we get set for our main event of the evening, this fight is being dedicated to the memory of Stan Hockman, Boxing Writer of the Year in 1991, who passed away last week at the age of 86. May he rest in peace. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from Turning Stone Resort Casino here in Verona, New York, Arthur Palullo's Banner Promotions, Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions presents our featured bout of the evening, sponsored by Corona Extra, La Cerveza Más Fina, Mexico, Live It to Believe It, and Hortensia Vodka. This bout is being sanctioned by the Oneida Indian Nation Athletic Commission. Executive Director is Dan Gustafson. Your three judges scoring this contest are Don Ackerman, Glenn Feldman, and John McKay. The referee in charge, when the bell sounds, is Benji Estevez. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from a sold-out Turning Stone Resort Casino here in Verona, New York, it's time for our main event of the evening. 12 rounds in the junior welterweight division. Introducing first, fighting to my right out of the blue corner. He comes in wearing camouflage trunks. Official weight, 139 pounds. A 39-fight veteran who enters the ring with a record of 36 wins, 34 of those coming inside the distance against three defeats. Hailing from Trelu, Chubut, Argentina, he is the former WBC junior welterweight champion of the world, Damas y Caballeros. Presentando Lucas La Máquina Matisse. And his adversary fighting to my left out of the red corner. He comes in wearing black and gold. Official weights 139 and one half pounds. His record 24 wins, 17 of those coming by way of knockouts against three defeats. Joining us and representing Berriozovo, Russia, he is the former WBO junior welterweight champion of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, Dami Gaspada, presenting the Siberian Rocky, Ruslan Provodnikov. And your referee in charge here to give instructions, Benji Estevez.
Let's go, let's get him out, let's get him out. Okay, Lucas, Ruslan, you already received your pre-bout instructions. Ya recibiste tus instrucciones. I want a clean fight. Una pelea limpia. Obey my commands at all times. Obedece mis instrucciones todo el tiempo. Most importantly, protect yourself at all times. Mucho importante, protégese durante la pelea todo el tiempo. We got you. Buena suerte.
Probodnikov fought the fight of the year with Tim Bradley in 2013. Matisse fought the fight of the year against John Molina last year. Now will they fight the fight of the year against each other tonight? Here we go. Oh. Both are stiff punchers upstairs, Bernard. Logic tells you somebody is going to want to try to get to the body early. My guess is it will be to Provodnikov.
Yes, yes, Provodnikov, he's going to try to get him inside and work the body. You know, Matisse, you know, he has some boxing skills, as you see, moving sometimes left to the right, and that's what he's going to have to do early in this fight.
Matisse's trainer told us yesterday in our meeting with them, if this can become a boxing match, if I can get Lucas to focus on boxing, he will have a big advantage. But he acknowledged that Matisse often gives up on the boxing and goes to war to make his power felt.
Yes, it's in his DNA, but I believe he has to stick to that game plan for the first quarter of the fight, because if he don't, he's going to have big problems, because Ruslan, he loves to mix it up. He loves to trade punches. As you see, he's coming forward, and he's going to have to continue to do that early in the fight to wear Matisse down.
And what both fighters acknowledged in our meetings was it may start out as a boxing match, but eventually somebody's going to land something big, and that may change everything. Uppercut by Matisse. Right hand by Matisse. He's landed a couple of jabs early on as well.
And he's putting a jab out there just to fill with other shots he can get in behind that. He's not really trying to commit with the jab. This is a jab to actually distract Ruslan. Ruslan going to continue to come and push Matisse to the ropes, because he wants him at the rope. He needs him at the rope. He needs him at the rope where he can pound on him.
In the center of the ring, a slightly quicker Matisse may have advantages, particularly with his feet. Left uppercut landed for Matisse. Provodnikov coming back, flurrying from both sides in a combination. Good left hook by Matisse. All in all, it's been a very good round for Lucas Matisse, who has gotten off to an active and effective start.
And Jim, he done something that you don't see often. Double, triple the jab on the left hook, and then he tried to set the right hand up.
Stop at the bell, la campana.
Counter right hand by Matisse.
Round one to Matisse.
Take him against the rope, all right?
I cannot extend.
Head movement, no, use your jab also, okay? Huh? Use your jab.
Jab is poison, so I cannot extend.
Head movement. Once you put him against the rope, let's work to the body first. Right, combination, body and head, right?
Focus on the goal.
Very good. Keep your hands up, right?
Руки у головы всегда.
Lucas Matisse, sometimes a slow starter. In recent fights, he's been averaging 30 to 40 punches in the first round or two. Threw 71 punches in that round, landed 23. Much faster start than normal. Provodnikov only 6 of 31 in a round one that seemed very clearly to go to Lucas Matisse. 1-2 by Matisse, big left hook. Provodnikov is having trouble getting started, and Matisse is taking advantage.
Provodnikov is cut. He's covered with the left side, top eyebrow. He got hit with the right hand.
Good body shot by Matisse, landing very sharply. Straight right hand landed flush. There's the cut that Bernard talked about, right at the left eye of Provodnikov.
Matisse just threw a straight right hand. When he started putting that left hand, which he just did, that's going to be a big factor. He's pinning two or three punches together, Jim, and that spells trouble.
Right now, it's very one-sided, and Provodnikov doesn't look nearly as ready for the combat as Matisse has been in these first couple of rounds.
It's target practice right now, Jim.
And the crowd is chanting, Matisse, Matisse, Matisse. Uppercut by Matisse. Straight right hand by Matisse. Provodnikov just can't get going.
And Matisse done something real smart. He got in, he grabbed, and he let go, and he started punching.
What a reversal. Those who saw Pravatnikov-Bradley will remember that Pravatnikov nearly knocked Bradley out in the first round with a tremendous start in that fight, and then knocked Chris Algieri down twice in the first round last year. Here, he's getting hammered by Lucas Matisse in the first couple of rounds and really seems not yet to have gotten on track. Uppercut again by Matisse. From range, but no problem.
Matisse is very sharp. Ruslan is wide with hooks, right hooks, left hooks. And Matisse is cutting right down the middle, or he's coming right up the middle.
And the blood trickling just outside the left eye of Pravatnikov. Pravatnikov leads to land some solid shot, something big, to have the feeling of getting into the fight the way Matisse's been into it already for 5 full minutes. Body shot by Pravatnikov.
Pravatnikov's heart might hold up, Jim, but I don't believe his face is going to hold up as this fight continues to go on.
Great point. Pravatnikov finally landed a left hook. Gave the Pravatnikov fans in the crowd a little energy. But it's been all Matisse for the first couple of rounds. He looks very loose, very confident, very in command of the fight. Another left hook for Pravatnikov.
Matisse is trying to throw that right uppercut every now and then after you throw combinations. But Ruslan just come back with a full 5-punch combination.
And now Pravatnikov lands a big left-hand shot that momentarily backs Matisse up. Probably thought that cut came from a punch, but no. There's the headbutt, which created the cut above Pravatnikov's left eye.
Yeah, they both leaned in after they threw a punch and they connected. They connected with heads.
And the lucky man is Matisse, as his face held up. But Pravatnikov now has a very problematic cut above his left eye. Harold Edelman giving the first 2 rounds to Matisse, and he gets off early in the third as well.
He's very sharp. Very sharp, Jim. Matisse is. He's throwing punches straight down the middle. Then he's coming up the low uppercuts every now and then. Right hand, uppercut, he tried to get there.
When you describe a fighter as being very sharp, Renaud, is the primary indicator the accuracy of his punches?
The accuracy of his punches, yes. And just the consistency of the you know, like a radar type of effect. He's throwing punches where he wants them to be, and he's making them look very, very sharp doing that.
Pravatnikov landing a left hook upstairs and a little nip at the body. It's so much harder for Ruslan, whose arms are considerably shorter than those of Matisse. He's got to get closer. And as you heard Marvin Simoteau say to him, between rounds, you've got to back Matisse up against the ropes.
I would like to see Matisse throw punches to the body every now and then, because he already made his point upstairs. He throw the left hook or throw the right hand to the body, I think he'll get a lot more results.
And as Pravatnikov begins to duck and slip just a little bit more effectively and lands a punch here and there, you already heard Bernard Hopkins say his heart will keep him in the fight, although maybe his face won't.
Again, Matisse's left, right, he's moving just enough, Jim, to be able to set that right uppercut up. If he can get there, it'll be very devastating for Ruslan to overcome that.
More clean shots from Matisse. Jab and a straight right hand. Another left hook lands for Provodnikov. Now right to the body. Matisse still firing back upstairs. Solid right cross from Matisse. Provodnikov walking right through it as he tries to pin Matisse to the ropes with no success. None at all in this round. Now Provodnikov backs Matisse up and gets him on the ropes where he wants it. Provodnikov shrugging off the blood above his left eye as round four begins. Harold Lederman, how'd you score the first three?
Okay, Jim, I got it 2-1, 29-28, Lucas Matisse. You know, Jim, I gave round three to Ruslan Provodnikov. I thought he was more aggressive, landed some good shots coming forward. About the cut. The cut was caused by an accidental headbutt. Benji Esteves ruled it an accidental headbutt. So if the fight gets stopped due to that cut after four rounds, we go to the scorecards. Before the fourth round, it would be a no contest. 2-1, Lucas Matisse.
Bernard, Matisse dominated the first couple of rounds. And if Provodnikov, in fact, won the third, it was pretty close. But another difference here is that Matisse, who got off early with big shots to the head, is still throwing to the head. And it's Provodnikov who's mixing in body shots here and there.
Yeah, I mean, he is. That's his style. He's not going to abandon that style. And you know what? It's going to be more negative to him more than positive, because I think Matisse is sharpshooting now, and he's coming up left uppercut just now. He didn't put anything behind it, but once he put these punches together, I believe that he's going to get a great results out of it. But as long as he throw one punch, two punch, Ruslan going to be around for a couple more rounds, maybe the whole fight. But you know, his face is so badly bleeding, I don't think that he's going to take too many of those straight shots like that as the fight go on, Jeff.
So there's a limit to how long Ruslan can expect to hang in the fight with his eye bleeding the way it is, and therefore a greater sense of urgency for him. And you're suggesting that by focusing on the body, Provodnikov might be setting Matisse up for big counter shots upstairs.
Absolutely, and also the referee is watching very carefully, as I watch the referee. But again, he's mixing it up. Ruslan is, you know, he's got heart. He's determined. He's a really game fighter, and he's going to fight to the end.
Left hook by Provodnikov. Little by little, Provodnikov is eking his way back into the fight, although Matisse got off to a tremendous start in the first couple of rounds and appeared headed toward domination. Great right uppercut by Matisse. Provodnikov shrugs it off and comes back with a combination. Left hook by Provodnikov. Right cross by Provodnikov. And Matisse wraps him up.
And I think, you know, he's winning this round right here. I mean, he got hit with some shots, but he's throwing his own, getting his own pound of flesh himself.
Great body shot by Provodnikov and a right upstairs. Ducks a right hand from Matisse and lands a left hook.
Step out the bell, Campana.
Big left hook from Provodnikov brings the fans out of their seats.
Campbell.
Another round that Ruslan may have won.
Absolutely. I mean, he fought, threw punches, took punches, but I would give him that round because he threw punches and he threw them with bad intentions.
Please. Don't exchange. I know you want it, but don't exchange. You don't have to fight him anymore. Right? What round is it? Relax.
Pocket now, right? Hey, when you stay in the pocket, can you work to the body for me? All right?
Here we go right now, and you got a jab, and then you have another jab, which is double. And Matisse trying to move to his left. And the right hand is blocked. But then later, here we go. Ruslan throws a big overhand right, catches Matisse. And I believe he won that round with those big shots he threw.
Total punches in round four. Matisse 21 of 95. Provodnikov 29 of 75. First time in the fight that CompuBox found Provodnikov outlanding Matisse, and now on Harold Lederman's unofficial scorecard, despite the great Matisse start, it's an even fight after four. Ruslan Provodnikov showing the guts of a burglar as always, coming back from getting hammered in the first two rounds and working his way back into the fight. And he's starting to land those sledgehammer shots that could give him a chance to win.
I see Matisse headhunting more than taking the body from his attack. He should be throwing more body shots and then coming up with punches up the middle or around the sides.
Well, as I said, I think that's how Provodnikov worked his way back into the fight. That Matisse was giving him the opportunity to throw to the body, and he did, while Matisse continued to headhunt and look for a knockout punch.
Yes, and Ruslan is going to be in the fight until the end, or until it goes the distance, or he take over. And this is where Matisse is vulnerable, when he let Ruslan stay there and continue to trade with him.
And the last thing we mentioned on those ring walks was Provodnikov's chin, the fact that he's never been down, and already he's shown you here what an advantage it can be. So because most fighters would have gone down in those first two rounds.
It's a big advantage that he has on his side, because, you know, he don't know nothing about being on the canvas, and he's not thinking about being on the canvas now. And that looked like a little trip up with the feet, but other than that,
when you think of the kind of precise boxing you saw from Crawford and Delorme in the first four or five rounds of their fight, and reflect that we're in the same division, it just goes to show you that two different worlds of boxing can exist within the same division.
Yeah, oh, absolutely, and that's a good thing. It's a good thing for boxing, a good thing for fans, and you know, I see some big things happening in that weight division.
Well, a fight between the winner of this and Crawford could be a very big thing, and it would present one of those style contrasts that fans love to see. Round five, yet another active round. Not much to choose between the two of them. Although, if anything, the harder punches have once again been landed in this round by Provodnikov. Matisse back to being accurate with his jab and following it up with rights and lefts.
Don't wait too long, okay? Once you have it, you throw the jab in the right hand to the bottom. Okay, just like sparring.
Okay.
Let's go, let's. That left hook to the body is working also. Sometimes you can use that.
Power punches through round five. CompuBox count. Matisse 110 of 207. Most of those were in the first two rounds. Provodnikov 84 of 258. Many of those were in the last two rounds. We come to the sixth of a scheduled 12. The cut man in Provodnikov's corner is Eddie Ackaway, and he's doing the best he can to keep that giant cut above the left eye from opening up and further bothering Matisse. So far, you'd have to say he's doing a good job, of Provodnikov. And so far, you'd have to say he's doing a good job, because Provodnikov is still in the fight and seemingly thriving the last couple of rounds despite the bleeding and the swelling. Tremendous shots by Matisse. The accuracy returns.
And also the power by Matisse. Those three punch combinations was meant to get his attention. That is Ruslan.
Left hook lands for Matisse. Very powerful with that punch. Right cross from Matisse, equally powerful with that punch.
Again, Matisse throwing great shots upstairs, Jim, but he's not going back to the body with the left hook or right hand.
And Probodnikov continues to invest in the body, even while being beaten to the punch and hammered upstairs by Matisse. This is a big round so far for Lucas. Matisse comes from cattle country in Argentina. His father was a professional boxer. His mother was a boxer. His brother was a professional boxer who's now a trainer. His sister is a professional boxer. He's known boxing all his life, ever since infancy. Probodnikov comes from one of those tiny, hard-bitten, impoverished Siberian towns where life itself is a fight for everyone.
Jim, he just got hit with four punch combination, and that stung Ruslan real bad because he stopped and he just paused for about a second or two.
I find it hard to believe there's another 140-pound fighter in the sport who would still be standing after taking those flush shots from Lucas Matisse.
Absolutely. I mean, he throws those punches not only hard, but he throws them accurate and sharp.
Round six has been a tremendous spectacle for Lucas Matisse, and you can see the CompuBox numbers. He's landed 40 punches in the round to only 7 for Probodnikov. And still, Probodnikov throws with all his might. And looking at Probodnikov, I'm reminded of what you said in round three, Bernard. His heart might keep him in the fight. His face may not be able to do so.
Lucas, very good. Perfect, perfect. Sit, sit, sit. Perfect. You're showcasing yourself, Lucas. Sit. Breathe now, breathe. Deep breath. How are you doing? Very good, very good.
Show me the reason why you don't want me to stop the fight. Hey? Right? You got to work behind the jab. What happened to your body work?
Why not the beat?
Okay?
Marvin Simoteo saying, show me the reason you don't want me to stop the fight. The suggestion being another round like that one, and Simoteo may feel it's the better part of valor not to continue. Harold, how do you have it through six?
Don't cry for me, Argentina. 4 rounds to 2, 48, 46, Lucas Matisse. I'm sorry, 58, 56, Lucas Matisse. Jim, I thought he won round 5. He won round 6. He won the first 2 rounds, 4-2. You know, he's landed that left jab and that straight right hand constantly. And Probodnikov obviously being bothered by the blood going into his eye. 4 rounds to 2, Matisse.
Harold, how close was round 6 to being a 10-8 round?
Very close, Jim. But, you know, Ruslan Probodnikov lands some, you know, huge shots, even in rounds that he loses.
Well, Jim, he's getting pop shot now, and he's getting hit with left hooks. He got hit with a body shot early in the beginning of the round. That sort of got his attention. But Matisse still continued to go one time or maybe two every now and then, but he should go down there more often and then go back upstairs.
There's blood streaming from above the eye. There's a big swelling under the eye. But so far, the lids still seem to be open. Is it affecting his vision anyway?
Yeah, I mean, his blood running down his eye. He already got the gloves hitting him and taking his vision. Just got hit with a stiff jab just now. Of course, yes, it's bothering him. But he still comes back with 2-3 punch combination. You know, Joe, I wanted to say, in my time of watching boxing in my life, I've seen two fighters that had the heart, like Ruslan and also the great late Arturo Gatti. I mean, this guy is not going to quit. He's going to continue to try to win somehow in some way.
And we've seen Arturo Gatti in the past, the late Arturo Gatti, win fights when looking the way Probodnikov does at this moment. It's hard to figure exactly how he could do it tonight. But, of course, nobody would have thought he would win rounds 3 and 4 after the way he got hammered around the ring in rounds 1 and 2.
And that cut, Jim, and open up a little water, it seems. And you know, the referee's paying attention, but Matisse has to step it up. This is where he needs to make his move now. Right, like, now, Matisse.
Do you like Benji Esteves as a rep?
Oh, yeah, he's professional. He stays out of the way. He stays at a right about distance to be able to help the fighter if he needs to be out of the fight. and make sure the fight is happening the way it's supposed to.
So remember, part of Pravodnikov's purpose in this round was, quote, to show Marvin Simoteau, the trainer in his corner, why he doesn't want Simoteau to stop the fight. I think he's gotten things back in gear enough, probably to convince Simoteau to let it go a little bit further, but he's still not in any kind of position to do damage to Matisse, because Matisse is assaulting him constantly and piling up the points. Let's take a quick sneak preview now of At Last, which follows this boxing match tonight. We're back at the Turning Stone Casino in upstate New York, the beginning of round eight between Lucas Matisse and Ruslan Pravodnikov. Harold Letterman's unofficial scorecard shows you part of the story, which is that Matisse is almost certainly well ahead in the fight. The other part of the story is that it's been a thunderous battle of traded power shots, and Matisse has gotten the better of it, except for in rounds three and four. It only takes a little bit of foot movement from Matisse to slow down Ruslan Pravodnikov's offensive attack. Pravodnikov almost needs, really, for Matisse to stand still to get off the kinds of punches that would get him back in the fight.
Or lay on the ropes. And, you know, Matisse is too smart, too seasoned to play that game, so he's going to continue to take those steps to the right or to the left and continue to pop that jab and every now and then throw straight punches down the pipe.
Great power punchers don't want to be big movers, but they do want to have the little subtle movements side to side, front and back, that set them up to throw their power shots.
Exactly. It gives, you know, a false message to your opponent, Ruslan in this case, that he's, you know, he can come in, but he can't, and he can hit with just a right hand just now for 1-2. That's what he's doing. He's leading him in. He's leading him in to hit him with something big.
When you talk about leading somebody in to set up hitting them with something big, we saw a perfect example of that in the first fight of the evening, where Terence Crawford really played Tomas Delorme like a tuna on the line.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he's another guy that mastered that type of, you know, false security that his opponent thinks he has. And then he shuts the lights out.
That's what Matisse is trying to do to Pravodnikov, but he may not be able to shut Pravodnikov's lights out just because of Pravodnikov's incredible chin, which keeps him going despite the number of thunderous power shots he has eaten from Lucas Matisse. Here's Pravodnikov with another little mini comeback that brings back those members of the crowd who are rooting for the Siberian Rocky and want to see him pin Matisse in the corner and unload some power, as he tried to do right there. And now Matisse backs into the corner again.
10 seconds.
Hard right hand by Pravodnikov.
Very good, very good. Luca, how are you feeling? You feeling strong? Good? Good. Okay, that's what I'm asking you. You know what you have to do, okay? You tell me what you want to do. What do you think? Don't throw that right hand just for throwing it.
Body and head. And then head movement, okay? Very good.
Here's Matisse going to the ropes voluntarily. Just know that he can see everything coming. He don't mind just giving Ruslan the false intentions that he think he can be hit, but he can't be.
Matisse seemed to take a little bit of a rest in that round. Pravodnikov got off more power shots and landed more. And Harold Lederman scores the round for Provodnikov, which keeps him marginally in the fight, down only 5 rounds to 3 after 8, despite the level of punishment which has been laid on him by Matisse. Now here comes Lucas again, firing from both the right and the left, trying to put Provodnikov back on the defensive.
And every now and then, Matisse, he sits, puts his hands up like the earmuffs type of style, and he's just really waiting for an opening from Ruslan to throw punches so he can counter, because he can see everything coming. Matisse, that is.
Provodnikov got a little left hook to the body, misses wildly short with a hook.
And Ruslan is starting to bounce a little bit. He didn't do that earlier, but he's doing it now, and I don't know if it's a strategy or not, or he feels that he can go ahead and get hit less. But
well,
he's coming forward.
Maybe he's doing it to show Samodio that he's still alive in there and still has a chance in the fight. Convince his trainer not to stop it. But, of course, the last round should have been good enough to do that. Good little left hook there for Provodnikov. And as the fight goes on, it becomes clear that although Provodnikov has very good power, doesn't have the kind of power Matisse does. He hasn't been able to bust up Matisse's face the way Matisse has busted his up. Good body shot.
But a good counter right hand by Matisse after that body shot also.
Here's another round in which the greater punching accuracy of Lucas Matisse is showing up.
He's been accurate all day. He's been accurate, you know, this whole fight he's been just shooting straight punches straight down the middle, and every now and then uppercuts here and there. But he's just so on tonight. He's so on.
You know, Bernard, Ruslan Provodnikov acknowledged to us yesterday that he has had some thoughts about shortening his career, that retirement is somewhere on his mind in the not-too-distant future. And, of course, there's an old adage in this sport that if you're talking about it, you're already retired. Do you think that's a factor here tonight?
Well, I don't think he's thinking about that tonight. I think he's thinking about how can he get this fight in his favor, even though it's 9 rounds and, you know, 3 more to go. Right now, Matisse has to go ahead and give him something to make him think that way. Right now, he's not. Matisse is not giving that type of feeling. And you know what? Ruslan just threw 4 or 5 different good shots. Maybe tied the round up.
He won the last 30 seconds of the round. If that sticks in the judges' minds, maybe he has narrowed it to 5 rounds to 4.
Very good, very good.
Just maybe.
Deep breath. Relax your shoulders. Okay. We only have 3 rounds to finish this guy. This round, I want you to be more busy. Right? Keep that left hand busy. When he stays still, go to the body right away.
Listen here, the jab. The jab right now. And then Ruslan throws a right hand, and then he throws a left. I don't think that's enough that he won the round, but it at least gave him a little hope he might think for the next 3 rounds to go.
Power punches through 9. Very much in Batisse's favor, 161 of 331 to 120 of 408. Very high percentage for Matisse, landing 49% of his power shots. Harold, how do you have it through 9?
Okay, Chip. I got it 5 rounds to 4, 86-85 Lucas Matisse. But, Chip, I got to tell you, I think Ruslan Provodnikov, the last 2 rounds, landed some hellacious shots and made this fight closer. Ruslan just doesn't stop coming. You think the guy's out of the fight, and all of a sudden, Matisse's landing left jabs, not the hard straight right hand he was landing early, and Provodnikov is landing right hands that would knock over telephone poles. So I think Ruslan has come on, made it a little bit closer, a 1-point fight, 5 rounds to 4, Matisse.
Fascinating. So Provodnikov, at least on Harold Letterman's unofficial card, is still in the fight, still with a chance to win it with 3 rounds to go, despite all the punishment he's taken from a very sharp Lucas Matisse tonight. 2 minutes left in this round, and it's a critical one. Neither man has really put an imprint on the round so far.
And I'm a little surprised, Jim, that Matisse ain't throw more punches than hard punches just to go ahead and get the referee's attention.
Trying to force the referee to stop the fight?
Well, trying to at least give Ruslan, you know, some type of, you know, feeling that maybe, you know, this might be it. This might be, you know, not his night. But he has to let his hands go, Matisse, to even get that reaction from the referee or Ruslan.
Hard left hook to the body by Matisse. Hasn't thrown a whole lot of body shots, but when he does, they're good. Right hand inside by Provodnikov.
And Matisse has great opportunities because Ruslan is coming in all the time. Right uppercut, left hook. He'll get some reaction. But as long as he's throwing straight punches, Ruslan is used to those punches all night.
Momentarily, Matisse was in the corner. Crowd got excited. Hard left hook by Provodnikov. Knocks Matisse back. Provodnikov's mask, a grotesque mask, but he's still trying hard and gaining some purchase here in round number 10. And this is fascinating, Bernard. Our Spanish interpreter, Jerry Olaya, tells us that between rounds the last time, Luis Pereira told Lucas Matisse, you are way ahead. You are winning by a wide margin. Normally, trainers won't say that late in a fight.
And I don't think he should have said that because I think the fight is a little closer. I believe Matisse is winning, but I don't think he's winning that
hard
far.
Right hand by Provodnikov. That was a critical round because at least on Harold Letterman's card, if Provodnikov won it, you've got an even fight.
Okay. Deep breath. Hermana.
Okay.
Here. Here, okay? This guy is on his way down, okay? Right? I want you, when you set up with the jab, and hard punches behind it, okay?
Tremendous uppercut there by Matisse, Bernard.
Yeah.
And then later in the round, this.
They both exchanged left hooks to each other, and they both connected.
Box numbers in the 10th round favored Matisse. 30 out of 88 to 14 of 69 for Provodnikov. Now we come to the 11th. Harold Letterman gave the round to Matisse, widening his lead on Letterman's unofficial scorecard. So now, at least on the Letterman card, if Provodnikov were to win the last two rounds, he'd wind up with a draw. You heard Marvin Simoteo telling Provodnikov between rounds, he's going downhill, he's running out of energy. Work your jab and bring big shots behind it. Hard body shot by Matisse. That could take some of the steam out of Provodnikov down the stretch. Quick, precise left hook. Now Matisse inadvertently backs himself into a corner and walks Provodnikov away to get out of it.
Matisse is touching with that jab. We call a range founder. And then he's going to try now every now and then to go to the body. I'd like to see him throw that punch, but I'd like to see him put a left hook behind that.
Stop. Time.
Now Benji Esteves has called time to ask for the tape to be removed.
Cortalo. Just cut it.
And Esteves is looking for some quick work here and not getting it. As Matisse's corner doesn't seem to have a pair of scissors.
Cortalo.
Esteves is getting increasingly upset as Matisse's corner fails to provide the scissors. And it's hard to say which fighter benefits from the extra rest here. But I wouldn't mind being Provodnikov standing over there and getting a breather.
Well, he benefits, Jim, because he needed a break. His face is busted up.
Now they're finally back to work. And Provodnikov wakes himself up with a left hook and a right cross. And an uppercut. And a little Provodnikov rally here in the middle of round 11. Body shots on a left hook. Another left hook. Matisse suddenly a little bit tentative as Pravodnikov tries to come on.
And Pavaka left hook. Left hook. Thrown it and got Matisse's attention. It buckled his legs. He got hit with a good shot just now, Jim.
That left hook was one of the best shots Pravodnikov has landed all night. And now Matisse comes back with his jab. Pravodnikov swings big.
And if you look at Matisse's left eye, I believe, is swollen left or right eye from that left hook.
Matisse working his jab to try to get Pravodnikov off of him. Pravodnikov gets him to the ropes, knocks him into the corner, lands a right hand, lands a left hook, lands another right hand, and another left hook. Huge comeback by Pravodnikov in round 11.
We said, Jim, it would be a war. We told people it would be a war, and it's living up to that.
Well, it doesn't have the drama of knockouts, but now it's beginning to develop the drama of an unlikely comeback by a fighter who appeared to have no chance. Crowd roars. They think Pravodnikov won the 11th.
Did you feel his power? Please. It's the last round. You're winning. We're 8 points up.
Come on, Juan, come on. Juan, you can land 3, 4, 5, okay? Let your hands go, okay?
Опусти руки, отдай все. Отдай все за своего сына, за всех.
We want to be a world champion
again.
Here's Ruslan comes up with a big left hook and got a reaction out of Matisse. His legs bobbed.
And between rounds, they began working Matisse's right eye with the end swell, as that was the eye that seemed to swell a little bit after Pravodnikov's left hook. Warm embrace for the two fighters as they begin the last round. Pravodnikov still digging. Harold Letterman's scorecard tells you the story.
The fight could be solved. It could be really, really mean this round. It's so important because the fight is close, at least by Harold Letterman's card.
Neither man has ever had a 12th round knockout. Not even Matisse.
I don't think Matisse should gamble and try to box or try to, you know, avoid any kind of comeback. I think he should just let his hands go and just, you know, stand still, hold ground.
He should do what he did in rounds 1 and 2. It's still the same Pravodnikov in front of him.
It's fresh, yeah. He has to go ahead and use
fire
that
away
to his advantage.
Be Lucas Matisse. Fire away. Don't make it look as though Pravodnikov has taken your game away. Big right hand by Pravodnikov. Big left hook from Matisse. Trading shots with 1.5 minutes to go. Pravodnikov's energy seems to be seeping away just a little bit. Not nearly as effective as he was on the 11th, when he was able to target Matisse with big shots. Matisse just jabbing and moving, trying to stay away and not get himself knocked out carelessly in the 12th. Left hook Pravodnikov. Hard right hand from Pravodnikov. Backs Matisse up. Only 40 seconds to go.
Matisse haven't threw a punch now in quite a while, but he has to let his hands go. 30 seconds.
Good body shot by Provodnikov. Tape coming off of Matisse's glove again. Benji Esteves not going to stop the action here. 15 seconds to go. Provodnikov seems to be winning the round, but if so, by only a very narrow margin. Celebrating what they believe is a Matisse win. And maybe it wasn't as explosive and dramatic as in our wildest imaginations we thought it would be, but it was a hell of a fight.
It was a hell of an action fight. And, you know, the crowd here at Turning Stone was hollering, screaming. It was a good fight. It was a fight that means something for what happens next.
Harold Letterman, you had it 105-104 coming to the 12th round. Who won the 12th?
Jim, I thought Ruslan Provodnikov won the 12th. I thought Ruslan Provodnikov staggered him in the 11th. I think the fight was so good, I called it a draw. I've got it 6 rounds apiece, 114-114.
Several prominent writers on Twitter showing the same score that Harold Letterman has.
Of course!
114-114.
There's no doubt about it!
And who are the official judges, Harold?
Okay, Jim. Don Ackerman, president of the International Boxing Hall of Fame. He had Gradovich decision over not, yeah, he had Gradovich over Dib. That was the right score. Don usually does a good job. Nice man. Now, let's talk about Glenn Feldman. Last week, he killed me. This is a guy that's a really good judge. Last week, he scored Peter Quillen 10-9 in the third round of a fight with Andy Lee. When Peter Quillen scored a knockdown, the fight turned out to be a draw. It should have been 10-8 in the third round, and Quillen should have walked away with the WBO middleweight title. John McKay, good judge from New York. You see, he had Willie Monroe over Brian Vera. Willie Monroe got the shot at the Triple G because of that decision. So, good job. John McKay will do a good job tonight.
We'll talk about Quillen Lee because that knockdown was facilitated by a foot on top of Andy Lee's foot.
Yeah, but the referee said it was a knockdown.
There you go. I know. I understand what you're saying. Let's go to Ray Flores, the ring announcer, with the official scores.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we read the official scorecards, please give these two warriors of the ring a round of applause for an unbelievable fight inside this ring. After 12 rounds, we go to the scorecards. Here are your score totals. Judge at ringside, Don Ackerman, has the bout 114-114, a draw. Overruled by judges Glenn Feldman and John McKay, who have the bout 115-113 for your winner by majority decision, Lucas La Machina.
So it's a majority decision for Lucas Matisse. As the work he did in the early rounds and the damage he did to Provodnikov's face stands up enough to allow two judges to find him the winner by 115-113, when our unofficial scorer, one of the three judges, and quite a number of writers at ringside seem to have had it a draw, 114 apiece. But the CompuBox numbers will significantly favor Matisse and bolster the notion, probably on the part of many fans at home, that Matisse won the fight. You see, he landed 126 more punches by CompuBox count. He threw nearly 300 more punches, 289, in fact, more punches than Provodnikov, or 279 more punches, I should say, than Provodnikov, landing at a higher percentage, 32%. Power punches. And you'll see edges here for Matisse as well. Landing 38 more, throwing 152 fewer, landing at a much higher percentage. When you connect on 47% of your power punches, you're almost certainly going to win the fight. And Punch Zone will show us some of the geographic evidence of where the punches landed during the fight. You can see that Matisse landed 35 body shots to only 24 on Pravatnikov. Matisse didn't do that much body work during the fight. That's part of the reason it would appear to us that Pravatnikov was able to proceed all the way to the finish despite getting hammered around the ring in the first two rounds. And of course, you see what happened upstairs with 123 punches landing on the chin of Pravatnikov. A lot of those jabs, of which Matisse threw many, many more than Pravatnikov in the fight. In fact, despite the effectiveness of his power punching, you might say that Matisse put the finishing touches on this, put the exclamation point on the win with his jab. And here's Lucas Matisse of Argentina here at ringside after the thrilling victory over Ruslan Pravatnikov. And Jerry, let's start with Lucas. We were told that late in the fight, your trainer, Luis Pereira, suggested to you you were winning by a wide margin. So in light of that, are you surprised that the scores were as close as they were?
No, really, I didn't hear what the points were. I just didn't hear it.
Well, it was a close fight, as the judges saw it at the end, and this despite the fact that you hammered Pravatnikov in the first couple of rounds. At the end of round two, with Pravatnikov bleeding badly over his left eye, and after all the shots you had landed, did you have it in your head that you were going to knock him out?
Sí, pensé que sí, ¿no? La verdad que le veía el corte ese y pensaba que lo iba a lastimar porque le daba golpes duros. Pero es una roca.
I thought so, yes, because I saw that cut and I was hitting him hard. But, you know, he is a rock. I thought it was going to hurt him.
So is his chin about as impregnable as any chin you've been in with? I mean, he took an amazing amount of punishment from you.
Sí, sí, la verdad que sí. Recibió mucho, le di mucho, bien fuerte. Me hice mal la mano, pero bueno, la verdad, un gran campeón.
He did. He took a lot of hard punches, and I even hurt my hand, but he is a great champion.
All right. You seem to allow him to get back into the fight somewhat in the middle rounds. Were you pacing yourself, realizing that it might turn out to be a long fight after all?
Sí, sí, salí a laburar, ¿no? La verdad que es un boxeador que tengo que moverme. Y a los primeros rounds me moví bien, pero después, bueno, me fue cansando un poco las piernas. Por eso me fui quedando.
You know, I came to work, and you know, he's a boxer, and that makes me and requires me to move, you know, and I started working, and I started moving my legs, and it started working for me.
We know that you hurt him, because we saw that from some of the shots you landed in the first couple of rounds. You buckled his knees a couple of times, and obviously did a lot of damage on his face. Did he manage to hurt you with any of his big shots down the stretch?
Sí, 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 sí. En algunos golpes sí, sentí la mano. En el 11 sentí una mano igual por acá. Que me tuvo ahí, pero bien, me pude recuperar, siempre estaba consciente.
Yes, for sure. You know, in the 11th round, he hit me to the side of the head, and I definitely felt that shot. And, you know, I got a little bit weak, but I always had to be very conscious of what I had at hand.
What do you have in mind now after this tremendous win? Are you focused on a rematch with Danny Garcia, or will you take any great fight you can get in a 140-pound division?
Me gustaría una gran pelea, ¿no? Si tengo la posibilidad, sé que soy uno de los mejores 140, ganando esta pelea, me gustaría tener... ser el próximo ganador de Mayweather Pacquiao.
You know, I'm one of the best in the 140 division. I would like to do whatever fight comes up, but I would like the best fight, Mayweather Pacquiao. That would be the one. I'm one of the best in the division.
All right, congratulations on a great show.
Muchas gracias. Un saludo para mi hija, para la gente de Junín, para todos los pibes que me ayudaron, para los pibes de gimnasio, para mi familia, para mi señora María, para mi familia allá en Trelew. Para toda la Argentina, muchísimas gracias. Y aguante Argentina, la concha de su madre.
That was for his daughter, right?
For all of Argentina, for his family, for his wife, for his daughter, for everyone that helped him in the gym, all of his crew, everyone that helped him. Long live Argentina.
And the entire fighting family of the Matisses. Thank you, Jerry, and thank you very much. Now here is Ruslan Pravatnikov. Vasily, let's start with the first couple of rounds. He got hammered around in the first couple of rounds, and a headbutt caused the big cut over his left eye. After those rounds, was he worried about his ability to finish the fight?
После первых двух раундов, когда ты проиграл, когда у тебя открылось рассечение, ты думал, что ты не сможешь продолжить какой-то момент бой?
Нет, выходя в ринг, я говорю своему тренеру всегда, что бы ни случилось, не вздумай останавливать бой. Либо я сегодня упаду, либо я выиграю любой ценой. Поэтому думать об остановке или прекращении боя у меня никогда в голове нет. Лучше я упаду.
Every time I come into the ring, I tell my trainer to never stop the fight. The only time that the fight will be stopped is I'm on my back, laying on the ground. All other times, I was going to fight until the end.
Is he the hardest puncher you've been in with?
I'm sorry?
Is he the hardest puncher that Ruslan's been in with?
Лукас Матис, это был боксер с самым сильным ударом, которым тебе пришлось боксировать.
Я думаю, что да. Да.
Yes, he was the hardest puncher that I ever faced.
In the middle of the fight, you were gaining purchase, you were getting back, you landed some big shots. Coming into the late rounds, did you feel that you had a chance to knock him out, or were you still thinking you could win a decision?
В середине боя ты немного выровнял ситуацию, а много нанес ему ударов сильных. А ты думал, что сможешь его в концовке нокаутировать? Как ты, тактика какая была в концовке?
Закончить бой любой ценой, то есть выиграть любой ценой, неважно, какой ценой она мне достанется. Вы видели, что я себя отдаю всего и не обращая на то, что со мной будет. Я дарю себя всем своим землякам, всем своим фанатам, которые за меня болеют. Я свое слово всегда держу. Я обещаю, что я всегда обещаю, что я дам зрелищный бой. Неважно, какой будет результат. Я свое слово сдерживаю.
I just wanted to win the fight, no matter how it came, by knockout or any other way. I go out there every time and I just fight till the end. I give it all, I give it 100%. And I just want to thank my fans and everybody in the building that came to support me. I promise before every fight that I'm going to give it all, and I give it all every single time.
And he did again tonight. Thank you very much, Ruslan.
Хочу поблагодарить и извиниться. Перед всей своей родиной, перед Россией, перед своими земляками, перед Югрой, перед своим народом, что сегодня проиграл. Извините, чуть-чуть не повезло все.
I would like to apologize to my fans, to all the people in Russia, to all the people in my hometown, in my region that I lost today. I feel so bad about it. I just want to apologize.
Tell him he owes nobody any apology.
Ты не должен ни перед кем оправдываться, ни перед кем извиняться.
Thank you. All right.